Yep, we've got quite a few. So, Jonny, whenever you're ready, you can take over the screen and I'll turn my camera off and I'll mute myself, but I'll be back with you and you'll have the breaks for the questions.
Brilliant. Right, well, welcome everyone. Good to see you. I'm just going to bring some things up on my screen that have decided to disappear. So bear with me. Okay, we've got the chat back. So feel free. I'd like to try and make this more of a conversation than anything. So please feel free to ask questions at any time to get involved and take me off in different tangents and directions. We're here till 12 o'clock, it'll be great to try and give you some as bespoke advice as possible. That would be the aim if I can achieve it. So help me by asking lots and lots of questions. So just to get us started, a quick poll, just to get a feel for where people are at. One second. So being honest with yourself, I want to know where your business currently is. So let me launch this for you. So is normality only a few days, weeks away, so that you can carry on with your business? So you're holding out for lockdown to fully end so that you can restart, or have you already flipped your business, offering different products and services, or are you working on new ideas and ways of thinking? So do you feel that normality is not far away? Are you waiting for lockdown to fully end? Have you already flipped your business and offering different things, or are you currently working on different ideas? So it'd be really good to get a sense for where you currently are, if that's all right. Be really helpful. We've got about a third of you that have answered the poll so far. So if you'd just like to answer the poll, that would be brilliant. My intention is to try and keep you as engaged as possible during this webinar, so that you're not emailing and making phone calls and making cups of tea. I want you here answering polls and asking me questions. So we've got 85% of you. Are we going to squeeze a couple more? Okay, well, brilliant, lovely, thank you. So let's show you the results. The results are interesting. 63% of you are working on new ideas and ways of thinking. We've got four of you that I worry about and think that normality is only a few days or weeks away. I don't know your products and services, but I'd challenge you and say, I'm not sure normality is going to be around for quite a while. That was 13%. Yeah, 7% are holding out for lockdown to fully end. I mean, this could be a year away. And brilliant that 17% have already flipped your business. That's really good to hear. I've got one more poll for you for right now. My question to you, it's about blogging. This is a blogging webinar. Blogging could be vlogging, so that's video or written content. So my question to you is, are you currently blogging? And if so, how often? I'll launch the poll now. Is it daily or weekly? Is it monthly? You don't really blog very often at all, or you've never blogged. Apologies if there's not an answer for all of you there, but if you could fill out that poll, that would be really helpful. So far we've got 70% of you that have filled out the poll. If we could just get a few more. Stephen's blogging hourly. Interesting. I'm probably talking about long form blogs. Bit more longer content. 85% of you have answered the question, and I will share those results now with you. Let's have a look. So we've got nearly half of you have never blogged before. A quarter of you are blogging on a really regular basis, and a fifth on a sort of a monthly basis. And we've got 7% that don't really blog. So interesting. So half of you have never blogged. Okay, that's so I will try and cater this for all audiences. Do you have any questions? What are you hoping to get from this? What are you hoping to get from this webinar? What are you hoping to learn today? What could really help you? So, Alistair, I was vlogging weekly until lockdown, but so many others have adopted it since. It's a very noisy space. Yeah, is that actually a barrier? So are we thinking that there's just, we're just never going to get heard because there's so much content online right now? You're looking, Nicola's looking for tips on how to create engaging blogs, how to get more people visiting our website. So if you do have questions, please do ask. Watch, the answer is shout louder. I'm not sure the answer is shout louder. Let me stop sharing that poll. Let me tell you, and Brian's asking how and where to blog. Well, I'm definitely going to be covering these answers, you'll be pleased to know. So that's good to hear. Let me tell you a tiny bit about myself. I'm a qualified optician. Gives me great credibility to be talking about blogging, doesn't it? I set up an e-commerce store back in 1999, during the dot-com boom. We were selling sunglasses, and we were the biggest sunglass retailer in the UK for about 5 years. We knew that from our buying power. We were buying direct from all the big manufacturers, and we were bigger than Shade Station. We were bigger than Debenhams. It was a fantastic business. We were at the top of Google for absolutely everything to do with sunglasses. So the word sunglasses, designer sunglasses, Armani sunglasses, we sold every single brand. And we were at the top of Google. It was brilliant. In 2004, so sort of 5 years in, we realized that that sales dropped, and we didn't really know why. And we didn't look at things like Google Analytics back then as much at all. And it took us a month to realize that we were no longer at the top of Google. We'd been pushed way down the ranks, and in fact on page 7 of Google for all our key terms. It was a bit of a disaster. We lost 40% of our business over an 18-month period. We went through a couple of SEO agencies, and they couldn't solve the problem. In the end, I found a guy in New York 18 months later who was on $250 an hour, but within 2 weeks he got us back to page one, and I learned a massive amount. I became really frustrated with the industry. I was a minority shareholder of the business. We needed to invest, and I decided to go off and help businesses understand what SEO was all about. So that's sort of how I got into marketing. So John's asking, I would be interested in how to blog to engage with customers more. we've got some other comments. Diane, as my business depends on hotels and venues opening, I need to keep my customers interested in business and get new customers. Well, yeah, we're all in different positions right now, aren't we? So some of us are able to sell products and services right now, and some of us simply aren't. So I've just got one more poll for now. And what I want to know is, it's sort of some of the things that we've potentially just been loosely talking about. So how do you feel about marketing right now in this current climate? Is it time to invest and market strongly? Is it time to save money? Marketing isn't the top priority. Want to market but worried it will send the wrong message? Don't know what to do or don't know how to do it? So there's a few options there. I've got a poll. It's just launched. If you could answer the question, how do you feel about marketing in the current climate? Is it time to invest and market strongly? Time to save money. Marketing isn't the top priority. Want to market but worried it'll send the wrong message, or don't know what to do or don't know how to do it. Let's find out where you are all at. We've got half of you that have voted so far. The others that are getting a cup of tea or sending an email, stop, come back, fill out the poll. I'll just give you a few more seconds to do that. Come on, we've got 67%. Let's get a few more. Some of you can't see the poll. Ooh, it will be on your screen somewhere, depending on what device you're on as well. Apologies, I can't give you some proper help right now on that. But we've got 75%, so I'm going to go with that. Let's have a look. Let's just squeeze a couple more in there. There we go. Let's have a look. So 57%, time to invest and market strongly. Brilliant. I think that is a very good and wise decision. 14% are worried about sending the wrong message. I get that completely. And a fifth of you are not sure what to do or how to do it, some of you as well. And Liz is saying, I think marketing would send a wrong message right now. I believe it's about staying in communication and talking about the things that are changing people's lives. Well, what I'd argue with you, Liz, there, is that actually what you're suggesting doing, I think, is marketing. So I agree that certain types of marketing are totally the wrong type of thing. But actually, what you're talking about there is communication, staying in contact, talking about what's going on in people's lives. For me, actually, is really good marketing. So it's interesting how how some people see what marketing actually means. And for me, you should actually be marketing all the time, but it's about what's the message. And if we have a look back at the Great Depression, many years ago, if we have a look at history and we have a look, what happened was Kellogg's in the cereal manufacturers, Kellogg's doubled their marketing spend, whereas a lot of other cereal manufacturers stopped spending totally. They wanted to save money. They didn't want to put the wrong messaging out. Kellogg's doubled their spend, and they came out of the Great Depression as the market leader with 30% profit, an increase of 30% profits as well. So for me, there's certainly something you can learn from history. I'm not suggesting that any of us are the next Kellogg's, although, you know, why not? We might be. But for me, it's about actually taking the opportunity and really defining what our business is right now and differentiating. And whilst we have to secure our business and become resilient, we also have to take the opportunity and work on it as well. Alistair, it doesn't always mean advertising. We have been offering reduced cost and even free options to those affected by the current situation. Okay. So if you do have questions, please do drop them into the chat or the Q&A. The Q&A means that I probably won't miss them as much, but either way, feel free. One thing to note, by the way, some of you are putting comments in the chat, but your drop down is still showing as all panelists. You can change that to all panelists and attendees, and that means that all of us, including everyone that's watching, can see your comments as well. So for me, the key here, and based on my background and based on how I got into this, is understanding search engine optimization. Because I think there's a huge amount that you can get from blogging. And one of those things is search engine optimization. And when I talk about blogging, I am talking about video as well. So it could be vlogging. So it should be, you know, vlogging or blogging. It's the same word, really. One's written, one's spoken. Or it could be podcasts even as well. So those are counted as blogging in my opinion. I'm sort of encompassing them all together. I'm not talking about Twitter statuses or Facebook statuses. I'm talking about more sort of 500 plus type pieces of content. I'm not talking about 30-second videos. I'm talking about sort of 3, 4, 5 minute long, maybe even 60 minute long types of content. But what's really important is to, from my point of view, is to make sure that you guys understand search engine optimization first. So I'm going to focus firstly on search engine optimization, just to make sure that we're all on the same page with that and we understand the basics of that. So SEO, getting higher in Google, this could be getting your LinkedIn profile higher, or could be getting your website higher. It's about ensuring great content. So having great content, ensuring that the content is accessible to the search engine. So that's typically the technical aspect, making sure that the website is mobile friendly, or that Google can understand the content. Making pages across the site unique and relevant, and making content popular. Anything that's popular is always going to do well in Google. And it's about good PR as well. So it's about traditional PR, but online. So that's what we typically talk about, link building, links to your website. And blogging, I think, can really tick a lot of these boxes. It's around the good content. It's around the thinking about keywords. And it's also about getting good PR, and good blog content can really achieve good PR. If we do have questions, please do ask. I am happy to answer questions at any time. There's two sides to search engine optimization. There's the website itself. So that's about the on-site, the actual website. And then you've got the off-site side of things, which is everything that's going on around the World Wide Web, around your website. So if we look at the on-site side of things, we've got keywords. We've got the content, we've got the technical aspect, we've got the usability. So if I'm on a mobile phone, Google knows I'm on a mobile phone, and Google only wants to show me websites that work really well on a mobile phone, because Google doesn't want to give us a bad experience. And it only wants to give us websites that answer the things we want, that are relevant, that are popular, that are resourceful and that work well and that are technically sound. So there's a lot of tick boxes to make sure that you're technically sound and the usability is right on a website. But the other part of it is about keywords. And for me, it's not about just thinking, you know, we want to be at the top of Google for 3, 4, 5, 10 keywords. For me, it's a hundreds, if not thousands of keywords. If you want to be found at the top of Google for, let's say you want to be, you know, let's say you sell cars and you want to be at the top of Google for cars. Well, in reality, you're only ever going to be at the top of Google for cars if you're at the top of Google for Peugeot cars, blue cars, Ferraris, red cars, how to fix a car, et cetera. And there's hundreds, if not thousands, of keywords and phrases and questions all around the word cars. So a keyword list for me is actually having hundreds, if not thousands, of words in. And I would challenge any of you to have a list at least with at least 300-400 phrases, questions, keywords in it as an absolute minimum. I would say the average that when we're working with a client, the average would be 1,000 keywords. We've got some clients that have 25,000 keywords. So it's around having lots of keywords. And don't worry about how am I going to suddenly put them on the website. Well, you're not. If you've got 1,000 keywords, you can't do it tomorrow, and it would be very spammy if you did. So don't worry about how you're going to do it at this stage. Worry about having the list, coming up with a list of keywords. It's about good content. So the on-site side of SEO is about having really good content. And the more popular it is, the more resourceful, the more helpful, the more engaging, then all of this ticks the SEO box. On the off-site side of things, so the second side of search engine optimization, we talk about, ultimately, we're talking about links to the website. We're talking about you know, who's talking about us and who's linking to us. Now, the sort of gold dust type link would be things like the BBC linking to us, or a local council, or a university, because all of those are trusted websites from Google's point of view. But what we also want is relevancy as well. So, for example, if I was a solicitor and I was a member of the Law Society, then the Law Society linking to me would be a gold dust link, because it's a trusted body in the UK. Google can see that, and they're linking to me as a solicitor. So that's a very relevant, trustworthy link. So the off-site side of things is all about relevancy, the links, your reputation and reviews. As I said, just to keep reminding you, if you do have questions, please do ask anything at all, any direction, to do with digital marketing, I would hope, but anything to do with blogging or vlogging or how to or search engine optimization, please do ask, and I will keep trying to tailor this for you all. So there's a few different ways of measuring how well you're doing from an SEO point of view, and my advice is to measure your website on at least a monthly basis, so that you have some indication as to the bigger picture on what's going on. And you could use a tool like this to measure, but you could also use a tool like this to measure competitors and to get an idea of what's going on. So Moz.com is probably one of the biggest search engine optimization platforms in the world. They have a score that they call domain authority, and domain authority is pretty much what Google think of you out of 100. So the higher the number, the better, the more trusted you are, the more authoritative you are. And it's you know, I'm not saying that Google use this metric per se, but it gives you a very good idea of what Google thinks of you. Now, just putting Google into the tool, you can see they get a domain authority of 100. The BBC get an extremely high domain authority. The average website domain authority is probably only about 25 out of 100. Nicola's just asking, is it free to use? I can see Liz has got a question as well. I'll come back to that in a second. Nicola's asking, is it free to use? It is free to use. Well, just to be clear, it is free to use. So Stephen, don't worry about the $150 a month. To get the data that I'm suggesting, you can use it 10 times a month to get your domain authority or a competitor's domain authority. And that's having a totally free account. And I'm not suggesting to spend any money with them. Different businesses might have different reasons to spend money with Moz. But my message here is not to start spending money necessarily with Moz at all. Although, of course, they will try and get you to. I don't think you necessarily need to at all. My point is getting your domain authority because it gives you an idea. So the average domain authority is 25 out of 100. And getting higher domain authorities, so the higher you go on the ladder, the more difficult it is. So to get from 10 to 20 is actually quite easy, but to get from 50 to 60 or 60 to 70 actually becomes more and more difficult. Petra's asking, what does it mean if there's no data for this domain? It could be a few different things. So it could be that firstly, you're not putting the exact details in correctly. So for example, we need to be sure that we're putting HTTPS or HTTP, depending on your website. We need to be sure that we're putting the W's or not using the W's, depending on your website. So there's four versions typically that you could type in there, and we need to make sure that you're using the correct version. And to find the correct version, you'd Google yourself and have a look at what Google sees you as, or visit your website and try the four versions and see which ones work. So Liz is just asking a question. I'm going to take this one here, which is relevant. So I'll just answer that live so you can all see. Liz is asking a question. Is there a plugin that can offer similar at the back end of the website? Yes, I think there is. I think Moz does have a plugin, actually. What you can also do is there's a Chrome extension called SEO. Can I remember the name of it? Can I quickly find it for you? I will attempt. There's a great plugin as I said, on Chrome. The plugin is called... I'm thinking of something else. Just get the Moz bar for Chrome. That's all you need. So you can get the Moz bar for Chrome, and as you Google things, you'll see the domain authorities come up. So hopefully that answers that question. My suggestion to you is having a look at domain authority to get an idea of where you're at. Joe's entered the correct data but doesn't find anything. It could be to do with how old your website. If it's very new, then there won't be any data there. If there's no data, then potentially it's just not performing very well yet, or you don't have enough links to the website, or I've entered the data correct, but it's brand new. Okay. Typically these tools need at least 3-6 months to get some proper data. And for you to make any real difference in Google, you need sort of a 6 months worth of history as a probably minimum, to be perfectly honest. So if you're thinking of keywords, let's just take you back to keywords and how to come up with this. You know, I've suggested that you have a list of hundreds, if not thousands, of keywords. So how do you come up with this list of keywords? The first answer is actually just go to Google and start typing things in, because what Google will do is start auto-suggesting keywords to you. And what you'll find is that the keywords it suggests, the phrases it suggests, the questions it suggests are things that other people have typed in. That's where it gets its data from, and that's why it's suggesting it to you. So the first thing to do is instinctively, what do we want to be found for? You know, you could ask if you've got employees, you could ask them, you could think about what clients first ask you when they speak to you. You could think about what, when you answer the phone, what do people ask? When people email, what do people ask? You can ask friends and family. If you were looking for my products or services, what would you type into Google? So instinctively, you can collect some data. You can then take that data to Google and start typing it in and seeing what else comes up. The next thing you can do is you can take that data to Google AdWords. Inside Google AdWords, it has a tool called Google Keyword Planner, and you can paste a number of phrases and keywords into the Google Keyword Planner. And what Google Keyword Planner is, it comes up with more keywords to look at. And it tells you, how many people search for those keywords on a monthly basis. The tool is there to try and get you to then start bidding and spending money with Google pay-per-click, Google AdWords. But you could just simply extract that data, download an Excel sheet and have a list of keywords. And just to talk to you about keywords for a second, don't think that just because the keyword has the most searches, that's the keyword to go for. A bit like if you want to appear at the top of Google for cars, you need to appear for everything else. We had a client in the States that wanted to appear at the top of Google for gifts and gift ideas. And my suggestion to them was, okay, that's great, but it's going to cost you a lot of money. Let's have a look at some of the longer tail keywords where there's not as many searches. But if we can cover some of those longer tail keywords and we can rank high for them, then the chances of conversion are actually much higher. So for example, here we found retirement gift ideas for women. It's got a very low search volume, only 1600 a month compared to gift ideas it's not on the screen, but gift ideas, you know, had 2 million searches per month or something like that. So far less, but to rank high for a phrase like that is actually a lot easier, and a blog could even do that. And if you've then got a good resource or good answers or good product on that page, the chance of a conversion is actually really high. So my advice is to really, really push this. The bigger the keywords, the better. Let's just go off tangent for a second, have a look at a couple of these questions. So Liz has asked, which do audiences find most engaging, blogging or vlogging? Well, I think we all prefer video. We prefer video compared to text. The order it goes is text, images, video. Video, I think, is the creme de la creme. Images is next. Text is probably least. Now, having said that, we're all a bit different. We all consume content in different ways. And actually, they all work together in different ways as well. So for me, it's about having probably long form text with a video to support it, that, and the video brings people in. So I think you can use it in different ways. It depends on time of day. It depends on your audience. You know, which do audiences find more engaging? Well, the answer is, who's your audience? If we're looking at an audience of solicitors, I would imagine they'd probably rather be reading than watching a video. So I think it very much depends on the audience. And I think it's about how you can use all of these things together. Nariko has asked a question. So my recent blog consists of cartoons and don't have long text. Can I make blog keyword rich without having too many texts? Well, the answer is, unfortunately, this is where one of the problems comes in, because it sort of SEO tends to go against usability and design sometimes, and that can be a problem. So it's about how to have a good balance. But the short answer, Nariko, is that unfortunately, without text, it's very difficult to get keywords onto a website. So if you have a look at how some bloggers do it, they'll, as I said, they'll have a video where, you know, it might be a 60 minute video, 30 minute video of a really complex, resourceful blog, but then they'll have the transcript underneath. So they've got the best of both worlds. So the website has everything. Now, I understand, Nariko, you're talking about cartoons here. And I think for consumer blogs, retail blogs, consumers don't want to read loads about, you know, on a Topshop or M&S blog, for example. So it's about trying to think about how you can introduce subheadings, how you can introduce bullet points with some of these words in them, and how you can think about keywords in your blog titles even as well. So I hope that answered that question for you. I don't know if we've got any other chats in there. No. Okay. So longer tail keywords, there's loads of different tools that you can go to get more keywords. So I've talked about Google autocomplete. I've talked about Google AdWords, the keyword planner, but there's a list of tools here. You'll get a copy of these slides afterwards. I think this recording will be available. So don't worry about frantically writing things down. The people always ask box, the bottom right of this slide, is a really interesting one, because as you put a question into Google, it shows people also ask, and it's got a list of questions. And as you interact with that, as you open and look at these questions, what you'll find is that Google shows more questions underneath. So again, put a question into Google, see what comes up as people also ask, engage with the box itself, looking at the questions, and you'll see even more questions come up. A really great way to get some questions to include in your keyword list. So we've talked about keywords on site. I then talked about off site and links and things coming to your website. So if we think of your website being the center of a spider's web, so the very center is your website, and then as we go around, we've got concentric rings, lots of different points, and the aim is to have a cross section of lots of different points talking about you and linking to you. So you've got different layers. So each concentric circle might be a different type of link. So the first concentric circle might be social media. So that would be links from Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, et cetera, et cetera. The next concentric circle might be PR. So links from the media, links from newspapers, magazines, online journals. The next layer might be associates. So other businesses that you work with might link to you, talk about you. Another layer might be suppliers linking to you, talking about you. Another layer might be clients or customers linking, talking to you. There's lots and lots of different types of links. And what we need to think about is how we can get a cross-section of links, lots of different types of links from lots of relevant places, trustworthy places, that all link and talk to us. And I think it's really important to have this understanding and this mindset when it comes to blogging, because I think having this, the basic understanding of how blogging can power search engine optimization can really make a difference on how you approach blogging. Got another question from Liz. Are these all free? Which are the tools? No, not all of them are free, I'm afraid. But at the same time, I'm not suggesting spending any money, depending on the size of business that you are, to be perfectly honest. So I'll answer that one. So Michelle's asking about Moz. You need to go to, I should have said, if you Google Moz Link Explorer, you'll find the right place. So Moz Link Explorer, three words, Moz Link Explorer. So how can you get links? Well, there's loads of different ideas here. As we said, you'll be getting a copy of the webinar. We'll email it to you at the end of this as well. Here's a huge list of ideas on how to build links. And a lot of these come from blogs. So you might be putting some resources, some guides, some interviews, all sorts of stuff. And I think a lot of these topics form blogs, but these typically are ways to build links and ideas. So, it might be that you guest blog on someone else's website, and whilst you're guest blogging, you link back. So I blog on the Digital Knowledge Enterprise website as a trainer, and whilst I'm talking, I might say, and something I wrote about recently, actually for a bit more in depth, click here, and it links back to my website, and it's relevant and it's a trusted website. Press releases can get links. What we call creating link bait. So having something really great on your website that people then want to link to. And a really good example of that is halfway down on the right, the calculator. So I've got a client who is a family lawyer, and they created many, many years ago, well ahead of the game, they created a divorce calculator. They knew that people wanted to work out the cost of divorce, and they created a divorce calculator in a blog. And what they found was that that even professionals were signposting people to the divorce calculator, saying, well, if you want to work it out, there's a great calculator on this website over here. So that was a really good bit of link bait based on a calculator, which then got a load of links. But all it really was just a bit of Excel calculation in a blog. So there's loads of different ideas here, and this sort of hopefully gives you some and opens some thoughts. So why should you blog? Well, I think nearly half of you are suggesting that you're not blogging right now. So let's try and cover that. It's about, it's about giving you creativity. It's about, there's so many different reasons why you should blog. And here's a list here just to get you thinking. So for me, it shows personality. And why would you want to show personality? Well, I think that increases engagement. I think people buy from people they like. I think that one of the ways to get people to like you or to trust you is by showing your personality, being the real person. Blogging is a great way to show personality. It's a great way to communicate with existing clients. So how do you currently communicate with existing clients? Do you send newsletters? How often are they? What about if you were doing more resourceful things in blogs, and then in a newsletter, you could highlight some of the blogs you've written? They save time. I mean, I love this one because we do often get asked the same questions. They become the questions to put in your keyword list. They become the frequently asked questions. Well, if you've got some blogs answering those questions, saves a huge amount of time, because when someone next asks you the question, signpost them to the blog. Say, actually, you know, we get asked this all the time. Here's the answer. And what you do is you give them a really resourceful answer as well. So saves a huge amount of time, puts you ahead of your competitors, because if people aren't blogging or vlogging, then the opportunity is go and do it. I mean, half of this audience isn't doing it. So, you know, there's good chances here. I think that as I said, it gains trust. And one of the ways to gain trust, one of the ways to gain trust is by thought leadership style blogs. So that's about saying, this is what I think of the industry. This is what I think of the sector. This is what I think. This is my opinion. Sometimes it's about being a bit controversial as well. Not for the sake of it, but if it's relevant, be controversial. And it's a great way to gain trust. If you're blogging or vlogging, it means that you've got to consume content yourself and you've got to be up to date. So it's a brilliant, I genuinely find this in my own business, even delivering webinars like this, delivering things, doing training, blogging, vlogging, it means that I have to continually learn. I always want to be giving you the latest techniques. And so it's a really sort of passionate piece of advice, really, that in any business, it's a great way to make sure that you're continually learning by giving advice. It forces creativity. It adds value to your website. It gives you content for social media channels. It supplies content for email campaigns and so much more. The way I see blogs, they are the core of any marketing strategy. I'm going to pause for a second, see if we've got any questions, see what people are thinking so far. It would be good if you've got any questions, please do ask. How are we doing? Are we all right? Put a yes or no in the chat box if this is helping. Yes for yes, no for no. Cool, you're still there. Good. If it's not helping, let me know. Tell me how I can help. My blogs get syndicated quite heavily. I think it adds value. Do you agree? Yes, I do. Definitely. Rosie says, oh, yes. This is fabulous so far. Brilliant. All right, good. I'm glad I'm helping. Yeah, I think syndication is good. I think having a community around you that you can share blogs between, I think is really helpful. I noticed that still a lot of you are, when you're in the chat box, you're still only typing to panelists. So just above where you type, there's a blue bar and it says all panelists. You can change that to all panelists and attendees if you want other people to see. Just for other people's benefits, there are a lot of people chatting away, just not necessarily seeing it yet. Dan says there's a lot to absorb. Unfortunately, anyone that knows my webinars will find out that I give a lot of information. The great thing is you've got the recording afterwards, so you can slow me down, pause me, and take it in at your own pace. But I tend to give quite a lot, so I apologize for that. And it does, unfortunately, give you a lot to think about. So this is great. We've decided that blogging is a good idea. We've come up with lots of reasons. So these were the reasons why. But how are we going to blog, and how are we going to make sure that we come up with some really good content? Where do we start? Well, the answer is you need to feed yourself. So the idea here is that, you know, there's lots of noise. We talked about the noise earlier. There's lots of noise. There's lots of stuff. What you need to do is feed yourself full of content and ideas and see what else is out there and around. So there's some ideas on how to come up with this. So the first thing to do is subscribe to competitors. Have a look if competitors are blogging and see if you can subscribe to their blogs via email. If you can't, then there are some tools out there that allow you to monitor pages, web pages, blogs, competitor blogs, to see if there's anything new that ever comes up. And if there's anything new, it emails you and tells you. So if you can't subscribe via email on someone's blog, there are tools out there to monitor someone's page. What's best is if they have something called an RSS feed. To find out if a website has an RSS feed, if you just go to their website and go to, and then add on the end of their website /feed or /RSS, you'll find if there's a list of content that comes up in sort of quite a sort of simple way. So not designed, just black and white text, a bit like a Word document, I guess. And so if there's no subscribe to a blog, have a look if they've got an RSS feed, and then you could take that RSS feed, put it into a tool that constantly monitors the RSS feed, and then tells you if there's any new content. You could subscribe to industry related news. So having a look at what trade press or industry magazines or newspapers, could you subscribe to some of those? What about professional bodies or services? So if you're a member of an association or a professional body, make sure that you're getting loads of stuff into your inbox. I know this fills your inbox, but actually this is where some of the best blog topics come from. Create Google Alerts on niche topics. So Google Alerts is a great tool. Just Google Alerts. It gives you a place to be able to put some keywords or phrases. And every time there's a new bit of content around that phrase or around that keyword, it emails you and tells you. It's a great way to protect your brand and reputation as well, because you could put your brand name into Google Alerts, and that means that every time someone mentions you for whatever reason, you get an email and you get to find out. And that can really open some doors as well, because when you find out that someone actually has mentioned you, you can really make that conversation go even further. Think about all the products and services you have and that you offer. These help you come up with ideas. Keep notes of questions that clients ask you. What are your passions? What I do is I keep so on my iPhone, I've got a voice recorder. And if I'm walking or somewhere in a position where I can't type, I'll just go onto voice recorder and just download my ideas onto the voice recorder and then listen to them afterwards. So that's a great way to capture ideas. You have to excuse me because I've got something in the back of my throat. I apologize. Some kind of tickle. And then guest interviews. So could you maybe a virus could you bring some experts that maybe enhance the products or services that you offer? Could you bring them in and do some Q&As with them that turn into blogs or vlogs, etc.? So here's some ideas on how to come up with ideas. So I don't know if you've got any more questions so far. As you can see, please do keep asking them. This slide is all about the types of content that you could do. Okay, so there's all sorts of different types of blog content. So we've got traditional blogs, we've got interviews, like I just talked about, a Q&A. We could do case studies. Case studies could easily turn into a blog. This was the client, this was their problem, this was the solution that we came up with, and this was the impact that we gave. And they can make really good blogs. Reviews, taking some testimonials or reviews that you've received and putting those into a blog. Some of the experiences you've had, you could have a look at Google Trends to see what's currently trending and see if that makes some good blog content. I've talked about vlogs there, so all of this could be in video as well. Infographics make great blog content. So that's about taking some data and putting it into a visual format. And there's some really, really great examples of infographics. And if you Google your niche or your topic and the word infographic, you'll see some other infographics that have already come out. Coming up with lists. So 5 ways to do this, 10 things to do that, 8 things to do this. Lists are always a great blog and typically have create better blog titles that tend to be more clickable and more engaging as well. Content series are quite interesting. So maybe you're trying to give some advice, but you could give it over a series of 3, 4, 5, 6 blogs. So part one, part two, part three. And then what you're doing is you're always referencing back or forwards. So last week we talked about whatever in part three, here's a link to it. Next week in part five, we're talking about whatever. And what you're doing is you're creating an internal link structure between all these blogs for Google to understand the relevancy of the content around them. What it also does is it makes people want to subscribe. It makes people engage more because they might start at part four and then realize that there was, you know, a lot more to have a go at. White papers. So that's, you know, a really in-depth, more than a content series, a bit more in-depth. How-to guides, surveys and polls could make great blogs, podcasts. I talked about that earlier. Some of the top comments you've had turn into greater blogs, quizzes, checklists, history timelines, industry and events roundups, competitions, FAQs, ebooks, day in the life. I love that one. That's around the day in the life of you or your staff or both. So if you take different groups, if you've got staff or employees and you've got different groups of staff, maybe you could have a day in the life of different of them. So I think that really helps people engage with you as a business and really understand really what goes on behind the scenes. It brings that personality out, that increases the trust. It makes it, you know, people engage more with real things. And one of the points I've not made yet is stories are the best thing to use. Telling a real true story, helping really someone understand things through storytelling, make really good blogs. So what stories can you tell? What's your story? And what stories can you tell that help me understand more? So telling me about your product or service is great, but telling me how client A used it and how it made a difference helps me really understand it far more. So storytelling is really important. And the other thing to think about is, how can you blog elsewhere? So not just on your website. So where can you create some relationships where you can blog, get what we call guest blog, and blog on other people's websites? So I blog on a number of websites, including Digital Knowledges. And but I also blog on Fit Small Business, Sage, Fast Hosts, lots of companies that are related to the products and services that I sell. So whether that be small businesses or whether it be digital marketing or search engine optimization, those types of blogs are places that I blog on. Seven Stories, we found storytelling, not surprisingly, to be the best way to communicate with all our audiences, internal and external. That's from John Beattie. Good to hear. Good to hear it backed up. So I'm going to ask you another poll, if that's all right. What I want to know now is, have you been in contact with your existing clients during this crisis? And so the question I'm going to ask you is, well, it's on. The answer is you've got, you know, it's on the list still to do. We've done some communication with existing. We've tried, but not sure how to reach them or to get them to engage. We've picked up the phone to our core existing, or no, we haven't. So here's the poll right now. Have you been in contact with your current existing clients? So let's put some answers on there now to get an idea of where you are all at. So you might not have yet. It's on the list to do. You've tried but not sure how to reach them. You've done some. You've picked up the phone to some core existing. We've got 70%. Let's go for a few more people if we can. If you can see the poll, come back from your emails or your YouTube that you might be watching at the same time. I know that you're all devoted and taking constant notes. We're about to hit 80%. I'll let you have that. So here we go. Let's just end the poll and share it. So the results, 41%, we've got 41%. We've done some, and we need to do more, I guess. And we've got 41% that have picked up the phone. Well done to you. Pamela says, how could you doubt us? Well done to you for picking up the phone to existing core clients. I mean, yeah, brilliant. I think that's so important. If you've not spoken to existing, you really need to. I mean, some of the best sales come from existing. Some of the best recommendations come from existing. Some of you are not sure how to engage, and some of you need to do a bit more. So take this time to reflect after this and think about how you could engage more with existing, and potentially blogging is one way of doing this. Emma's asked a question, is it okay to replicate blogs when guest blogging, or do you need original content each time? So I'll just show you that question. So really good question, Emma. And the answer to that question is that it should be based on the audience. So if you're writing a blog on someone else's website, you should really think of their audience and try and accommodate for their audience. The best blogs are different blogs. However, to answer the question, you can duplicate them. There's no issue. You've got to be aware of something called duplicate content, which Google does have an issue with. But to solve the problem, all you need to do is, if you do duplicate a blog, at the bottom of the blog, you just need to simply say this blog was originally posted on and the URL to where it was posted. So, for example, some people blog on their website and then copy it onto LinkedIn articles, which is absolutely fine. But make sure that at the bottom of the article, you put this blog was originally posted on and the original link where it was. And that solves the duplicate content issue. But you know, obviously, if you can make it unique and different, then all the better. And let's have a look. We've got some other things here. Pamela, remember, our customers are also having to pivot and do things in a different way. So reaching out to them to help them just reinforces the trust. Totally agree. Alistair, I'm currently having our sign-up form redone to make the option of further marketing clear in order to comply with GDPR. Okay. So is that suggesting that it's therefore difficult to contact existing? I would probably challenge that and find a way to do it sooner. Emma, can you explain about categories and tags on WordPress blogs? Great question. So what we want to do is always make it easier for the user and for Google to understand our content. So what you need to do is take a look at your products and services, take a look at your keywords, and think about and also have a think about the types of blogs that you might do. And categories are a way to categorize your blogs. So you might categorize them based on products or services. You might categorize them based on sort of hot topics in keywords, or you might categorize them in terms of what probably how most people categorize them in terms of the type of blog. So for example, if it's an infographic, then one of the categories could be infographics. Another category could be how-to or resource. Another category could be fun. Another category could be charity. Another category could be company news. Another category could be day in the life. If you can make them more keyword friendly, then categories is a great way to power keywords. But always think of the user first. So if you think that having them in the way I demonstrated, where, you know, you categorize them as humor, charity, company news, resources, if that's better for the customer, then that's the way to do it. If you can think of how you could use keywords in the categories, then that would be another thing to think about. Now, tags take it a step further. So typically you might only have, you know, 5, 10, 15 maximum categories. Tags, you might have hundreds of tags. So what you do is you take a blog and you would tag it a bit like hashtagging on Instagram, a bit like hashtagging on Twitter, on Facebook. It's about basically saying this blog is tagged as, you know, if I was doing a 5 top tips on how to blog, I'd probably put it in my how to blog category. And then it would be tagged blogging, vlogging, digital marketing, SEO, assuming that all of that sort of stuff was talked about inside the blog. So hopefully that gives you a bit more idea on how to use categories and tags. You should definitely use them. You should definitely think about how to introduce keywords into them. You should probably only have sort of 5, 10, 15 categories, but you can have unlimited tags. And each blog should be tagged, you know, each blog might be tagged sort of 5, 10, 15 things, as long as they're relevant. So as long as what you're tagging is actually wording that you're using in the blog as well. Don't, otherwise you're misleading Google and that can go against you over time. So don't tag something, don't tag a word just to put a keyword in there if you've not used that keyword in the content. I hope that answers the question. And I'm really glad you asked it, Emma, because I think it really explains a lot more. Liz says, is that in the body of the blog or elsewhere? So what we've talked about there is the categories and tags is not in the body of the blog. That's a way, for example, on WordPress that you can tag a blog. I was talking about only tag something. So for example, I'll only tag it SEO if I mention the word SEO within the blog itself. Because if I'm, you know, if I haven't mentioned SEO, then why would I tag it SEO? And there'd be a concern that Google would see the tag and then think, well, hang on, you've not even mentioned it in the blog. You know, are you trying to cheat the system here? So hopefully that's answered the question. I'll just get rid of that. Narika, is it a good idea to go back to old blogs and tag keywords? Absolutely, yes. It depends if you've got time on your hands, though. And, you know, you don't need to be too particular about this. I'm not saying that you need to. If you do have time, maybe you want to go back to some of the best blogs or some of the last 3 months or whatever it might be. But yes, if you could go back and catalog them, then that would be definitely worth doing. And what you're also wanting to do is constantly link back to blogs as well. So I will talk about that a bit later on in the webinar anyway, but you also want to be always want to be thinking of that as well. Okay. Don't know if anyone has got any other questions or thoughts so far. Okie dokie. Commercial case studies. So, you know, the question is, has anyone won any business out of this? So I just want to put another poll. I've got two more polls for the entire webinar, so don't worry. I want to know, where is the question? I'm just trying to find it. Is it there? Do you feel sorry? We're just going to use the chat box for this one. So I want to know if you've won any business from blogging. So yes for yes, no for no. Have you won any business from blogging? So does anyone feel they've won any business from blogging whatsoever? So we've got loads of no's. Oh, we've got a couple of yeses now. Just started, so not sure. No, not blogged yet. Don't know, not tracked it. Okay. So we need to ask questions. When people come to us, you know, how did you find us? What did you look at? What did you type into Google? What page did you get to? All those sorts of things. I'm going to show you some of the case studies that I've had from blogging just to give you some inspiration and help you think about how you can commercialize blogging. Rosie's asked, how do you tag, categorize a blog? I probably wouldn't be able to go into the exact how-to right now, but for certain, if you've got a WordPress website, then you can easily tag or categorize. I would probably just go to YouTube and type in how to tag or how to add tags, how to categorize blogs in WordPress. If it's not WordPress, try, depending on the platform, you might be able to, you might not be able to, but I can certainly help afterwards. Feel free to contact me and I'll give you an answer with pleasure. And I think Wix does let you as well. You just need to Google to find out. Let me tell you about how I see blogging as the core of marketing. And I talked about that earlier, how it's the central point of all your digital marketing. The way I see it is that five top tips on how to do something becomes very easily five tweets for Twitter. It becomes very easily a debate on LinkedIn or a question on Facebook or pictures on Instagram or a video on YouTube. Once a month, you could send an email newsletter out and you could link to your top two blogs from the previous month. I typically advocate weekly blogging. It very much depends on this on your audience, the size of your audience, the type of audience, the products and services you sell. If you have a look at retailers and the consumer market, you look more at daily blogging. But I think business to business, you tend to be sort of weekly or bi-weekly or monthly. I'd advocate for weekly. And as I said, these blogs very easily turn into things for all your different channels. It defines the conversation that you're having in networking opportunities. So whether that's face-to-face or on Zoom, as we all are doing right now, it gives you the topic of conversation. So for me, people, when they've seen or heard things seven times, that's when they start really thinking about buying or being connected with you. And you imagine that you put a blog out, you know, this week I put, you know, how to find the best keywords for a blog, for example. And then imagine that, you know, I then tweet about it, I do a YouTube, I create debate on LinkedIn. I'm then in a Zoom networking and I talk about keywords in blogs. Somehow I get that into the conversation. Not in a spammy way, not in a forced way, but if there's an opportunity in that way. And what I'm doing is I'm reinforcing the messaging on a constant basis. So it's also giving me a topic to talk about. And if we go back to the power of blogging, this is making me creative. It's feeding me information. It's helping me learn. So actually, when I'm writing a blog, there's a lot of resource I've got myself that I can then go and talk about. So I really genuinely believe that blogging is the core, and I think it powers so many things, including SEO, including PR. PR and SEO are so related, and I'm going to try and demonstrate more of that as well. And I think it really, really powers these things. So just to give you some examples, and we're going back quite a while here, but they're hopefully good examples. So big data, it was a new word back in 2013. And I could hear my audience not really understanding what big data was all about. So I wrote a blog, The Big Issue of Big Data, 7 Terms You Need to Know. So the idea was to just sort of be helpful, be resourceful, and define what the 7 key things within big data was all about. And on the screen, I don't know if my mouse will point to it, but there's a just underneath the picture, there's a red link, big data link. And that link was going to a guy called Danny Brown, who is a marketing blogger. And he talked a lot about big data back in this time. And I follow him on Twitter. I like what he says. I read all his blogs, and he talked a lot about big data. So I wrote this blog on, you know, the things you need to know. I linked to him. What was amazing was, he then came and commented on my blog. Now, to get a comment on a blog is actually really, really tough, really difficult. It's very difficult to get comments on blogs. The great thing about WordPress, as an example, is that if someone links to one of your blogs on WordPress, WordPress tells you. So Danny does have a WordPress blog, and he will have got a notification from his own website that someone has linked to his blog. And I imagine that that's how he found out and came and commented. Now, nowadays, back in 2013, I wouldn't have thought of just tweeting him and saying, you know, I've done this blog and I've mentioned you and, you know, see what you think. But anyway, either way, I was delighted that he came and blogged. And I can hear some of you are saying, so what? And Joe's saying, well, I've turned comments off. Is that a mistake? And I'll come to that in a moment. But you could say, so what to this? But then what happened was Danny tweeted my blog to 35,000 followers. Well, that was really cool. I was very chuffed with that. HubSpot, which is the biggest marketing platform in the business-to-business marketing platform, arguably in the world. If you look at Danny Brown's bio there, he's ranked as number one marketing blog in the world, recognized by HubSpot. So he is a seriously big marketing blogger, certainly back then. He now blogs about mental health a huge amount and other things. But back then he was a serious marketing blogger, recognized by, you know, potentially the world's number one. I'm not sure about that, but certainly high up. He's tweeted my blog. Well, that was pretty cool, but I could hear you say, so what? He then blogged the next day and he linked to my blog. So he obviously liked what I said, but here was my gold dust link. This was the gold dust link of a relevant website talking about marketing, a trusted, high authoritative website talking about marketing, linking to me talking about marketing. Now, my intention when I wrote that blog was purely to write a resourceful, content-rich, keyword-rich blog. I had no idea that I was going to get a link from it. That's very powerful. Joe and Jane both turned off comments, worried that you won't have time to respond. God, listen, getting comments is so difficult. You're not going to be inundated with comments. And if you are, and that becomes a problem, then okay, turn them off or employ someone to answer them. But there's no way that you're going to be inundated with comments. It's actually really difficult to get comments. And I could do a whole other webinar on how to get comments. So I would have them as an ability, but I'd be surprised, unfortunately. I think it's really difficult to get them. So don't think this is just going to happen overnight. Nariko, do you need to ask permission when you link to someone's blog? Absolutely not. No, not at all. You can link to anything on the World Wide Web. Whatever is public, you can link to it. So you can link to a Guardian news article. You can link to someone's blog, someone's picture. You can link to anything at all. And it's so important to link to things. Google wants to see you linking out. Google wants to see people surfing the web. Google wants to see someone getting to your site, browsing around, and then clicking a link and going off to 10 other websites and having a look at 10 other things. The more things it sees, the more time spent and you've been part of that surfing experience, the more Google likes you. So the answer is definitely, first of all, you can link to anyone's blog. You don't need permission. But secondly, the more you link out, the better. And I'm definitely going to be covering that later on in this webinar. And it is all about linking out. Well, one of the many key things is linking out. I heard you say, so what? So, you know, he linked to my blog and I'm hearing you say, so what? But actually, this is what happened to my traffic that day. You can see a spike. I got an increase of leads that week as well. It was a really positive thing. I now chat to Danny on he's become a long-term blogger to chat with, and you know, it was a great thing. So that was the so what. Let me just give you a couple of other examples. This one was around, I noticed a conversation lost my train of thought for a second. This was a controversial blog. So I talked about how being giving opinion, being a thought leader and being controversial, but not for the sake of it, is always makes a good blog. And this blog was, I'm very passionate about WordPress, open source types of websites where there's no owner, you own it, and if you moved, you know, if you got a company like us to create a WordPress blog for you and you decided to leave us one day, it's your website. WordPress is public. Anyone can, there's lots of developers that can work on it. What we don't do is build websites in content management systems that are totally bespoke. And I'm against that for a number of different reasons. It's a bit of Marmite, bit of Coke and Pepsi, but that's just my take on it. There's a lot of agencies that have their own bespoke content management systems that have very good reasons why. But one of the issues is if you ever want to leave them, you can't because it's their content management system. So the issue then becomes is, you know, you're then stuck with them. So this blog was about that and it got a huge amount of engagement lots of chatter, lots of comments. So that was a great way to... Jane says, please do a webinar on how to get comments. So that was a good example of how to get engagement. And what this did was it opened a lot of doors into people wanting to... Well, it was a few different doors, actually. There were some doors that were around people trusting me more because they could see that... You know, I was saying that, look, if you ever want to leave us, it doesn't matter. It's easy to leave us. But the other thing was it opened doors into other agencies wanting to work with us because of some of the reasons I'd said. I'll give you another example of a commercial blog case. So this was, again, just trying to push keywords. I was trying to push the keywords online and offline marketing techniques. And what you can see is you don't need to have the phrase online marketing and offline marketing. So Google can see the sentence online versus offline marketing and can relate. So if someone was to write online marketing, they would, Google would be able to see that. I hope that makes sense. The key to this one was that, the story around this one was that I posted the blog. You can see it's back in 2011. And what I should say is that this was only sort of a few months after I'd opened the business. And this was, you know, only a few months after being an optician. I knew that to really make my business work, one of the things that I'd need to do is do some webinars like this. Actually, I wasn't thinking of webinars in 2011. I was thinking of doing, you know, how can I speak at events? And I'd never publicly spoken. In school, I shied away from it. I hated public speaking. It just wasn't me. I'd never spoken at any conferences, any events, anything whatsoever. And it's a really important bit of detail that I tell you this, because I posted this blog and then I get a phone call totally out of the blue. And it was a phone call from the name's gone out of my head, the Institute of Marketing Directors for Independent Schools. The word institute is wrong, I think. But anyway, it was the association, AMDIS, the Association of Marketing Directors for Independent Schools. And they said to me, and I promise you, you know, this, no word of a lie, genuine phone call. And this was absolutely the conversation. She says to me, just been reading your blog about online versus offline marketing techniques. She says, you've obviously done a lot of research on this. Well, I've done a bit. I said, yeah. She said, you obviously speak about this subject a lot. And we've got a conference in 6 months' time in Birmingham where there's 400 marketing directors. And we're just wondering what you charge. So she'd made a huge amount of assumptions. I'd never spoken before. First of all, I said, you know, how did you stumble across this blog? She said, well, I just Googled online and offline marketing techniques. It turned out I was at the top of Google for it at the time. I'm nowhere near now, but at the time I was very early in using some of the keywords, and I didn't realize, but I was at the top of Google for it. She made a huge amount of assumptions because of that. And, you know, no word of a lie, I made up a price literally in seconds during the phone call, and they paid that price, and I spoke 6 months later in Birmingham in front of these 400 marketing directors. It was such an amazing experience, and it was the start of my journey into public speaking. But it literally was from a blog that I had no idea was going to do that, because all I was intending on was being high in Google for particular keywords. And another blog, this one, SEO Leads. Who is the best SEO company in Leeds? This was a debate on LinkedIn. I noticed a debate on LinkedIn. Someone posted a question saying, you know, I'm looking for some SEO. Who's the best SEO company in Leeds? And there was loads of people giving answers. You know, we're the best for this reason, etc. And some bright spark came along and said, well, you know, Google best SEO company in Leeds or SEO Leeds, and whoever's at the top must be the best. I think the advice was Google SEO Leeds, and that was the advice at the time. And I saw that and I thought, well, no, I disagree. One of the reasons I disagreed was because I wasn't at the top of Google for SEO Leeds. That was a fundamental reason why I disagreed. But actually, the real reason why I disagreed was because I actually think it's very easy to get at the top of Google for certain keywords. And that doesn't mean that you're the best SEO company. So I took this whole conversation that was on LinkedIn, where people were giving recommendations and saying, you know, Google and whoever's at the top is the one. I took that whole conversation and I wrote a blog around it. And I basically said, look, someone asked this question on LinkedIn. This is what people said. This is why I disagree, mainly because I'm not there at the moment. And whilst I was writing this blog, I sort of told a story. I said, look, you know, I'm currently in position 99 of Google for SEO Leads. And do you know what? I really was in position. It was even, if it wasn't 99, it was 97, you know, page 10 of Google. If you go to this blog, you'll see the story and you'll see the data. I was in page 10 of Google for SEO leads. And I started naturally using these keywords as I was writing. So, I sort of said, you know, I wonder where I am for SEO company in Leeds or best SEO company. I came up with 10 phrases as I was writing. You know, it turns out I'm in position 68 for SEO whatever in Leeds. And as I was writing the blog, I said, you know, now that I've used SEO leads in the title, now that I've mentioned SEO leads a number of times in the blog, I wonder where I'm going to appear in Google for SEO leads. And I sort of kept mentioning the word SEO leads in a bit of a spammy way as well. And I mentioned, as I said, many other keywords, told the story of where I was. Within 2 or 3 months, I was in position 3 of Google for SEO leads. And for about 5 years, I was in that position. I've focused on many other things since, and it's not my key area. So, but if you have a look at the blog, you'll see the detail. And what I showed is that it's actually really easy to get high in Google. But that doesn't mean that you're the best agency. So those are just some stories. I'm just trying to give you some inspiration as to how you could get things out of blogs. I don't know if anyone has any more questions so far. It would be good to know if you do. I've got another poll. So let's just see which one we've not asked. Okay, yeah, this is the one we want. So I am going to shortly get into client personas and target audiences. I'm going to ask you a question about that. Karen's just asked a quick question. So Karen, any good reads you recommend for SEO? Yeah, going back to Moz, if you type in Moz Beginner's Guide, to SEO, you'll find a really, really good set of blogs that you could have a read of. Again, it's going to try and get you to spend money with Moz, but I don't suggest it. The other thing is there's a brilliant blogger called Neil Patel. If you go to neilpatel.com, he's got some amazing stuff on SEO. Those would be two. And then the last one would be having a look at Search Engine News. They have a daily email that comes out. Search Engine Land or Search Engine News. I think it's Search Engine Land, sorry. And they have a daily email that comes out and it sort of curates the sort of the best SEO blogs from around the world on a daily basis. So those are some of the things that you could look at. We've got another question as usual, a cracking seminar. I'm so excited to get going on my website. We've not even finished yet. What time are we on? Oh, we've got plenty of time. So I'm just going to put pure gold, brilliant. I'm just going to put another question out. Do you have documented documented your client personas and target audiences? So yes, we clearly define personas. We've got an idea about our different personas. We can sell to most people and businesses, so this isn't relevant. Not sure exactly what this means. No, not done this yet. So can anyone sell to most businesses and people, so therefore it's not relevant? That's the middle answer. Not sure exactly what this means, not done it yet, or you've got really defined, documented personas, or you've got an idea but not fully documented yet. We've got 60% that have answered the, Joe's working on it. Got 60% that's answered the poll. If you're making a cup of tea or watching a YouTube, just come back quickly and just answer the poll for me so that I can keep this engagement going. Thank you. Got a few more responses there. Could we get to 70%? Client persona is currently looking at this part of my short-term plan during lockdown. Good to hear, Pamela. Okay, we've got 75%. That'll do. Let's end the poll. Let's share the data. So the winner is we've got an idea about personas. And so you're currently working on them. Brilliant to see that nearly 15% of you have clearly defined them. The ones that can sell to most businesses and people, I'd put that there on purpose to trick you. And a couple of you took the bait. The reality is that I'd totally challenge you and say I don't think you can sell to most people and businesses. And I think you do need to define. I'll happily challenge you afterwards and help you come up with some. But there's also 30% of you that haven't done this or not sure what we mean. And I think, you know, if you want really good blogs, then you really need to complete this this section, this really understand how to come up with personas and target audiences. Once you've come up with target audiences and personas, you then need to have some kind of editorial calendar. So just being totally honest and frank with you, I've got the poll the wrong way around because I got a bit confused with the polls. So we're going to cover personas and target audiences very shortly. I'm going to just go into editorial calendars now, and both relate and work together. With regard to editorial calendars, this for me is the plan. So we've come up with why we should blog. We've come up with how SEO feeds into blogging. We've come up with how we can blog, how we can get ideas, how we can subscribe to content. What you all need now is actually a plan to make it happen. And we are going to feed into it personas, target audiences, and some other things as well. But this for me is the key to make it happen. So editorial calendars, I found personally, are the thing that really took me over the line to making things happen. So I'm going to get rid of that poll result. Sorry, it was still on your screen. So how to come up with an editorial calendar might sound complex, but it doesn't need to be. It gives you two key advantages: planning and accountability. So there's some really simple steps on how to come up with editorial calendars. Steve, trick question really, as I firmly believe we don't sell to people, they buy from us. Interesting. We know our target market, the business we want to work with. Interesting. So first step, how to come up with editorial calendar. The first step is to come up with a list of things and dates. Okay. So you come up with a list of things and dates. So in that list could be things like product launches. So maybe you've got a new product coming out or a new service coming out. What is it? When is it? Are you going to any, I know that lockdown and coronavirus is creating a very different time, but in the big picture over the next 12 months or even the next 2 years, what events or trade shows will you be going to? And some of these might be online as well. So there's nothing wrong with that. You know, there might be some networking events that you're doing. What are they and when are they? Are you doing any marketing campaigns? I'm not suggesting you should give 20% off or free whatevers, but if you do and you are, then what is it and when is it? Any promotions that you're doing? What holidays are there? So when you're selling to, I see what Stephen's saying about, you know, people buy, you don't sell to them. Okay, maybe selling is the wrong word, but I get what you're saying. But the clients and the customers that buy from you or that you're selling to or you're marketing to, what's going on in their lives and what do they relate to the most? And how can you relate your products and services around things that are really relatable to them? So for example, and I totally get that we're in different times at the moment, but Easter, Christmas, school holidays, these things will at some point get to some normality again. What are these things and how can you relate your products and services to them? So, you know, typically during summer holidays, might be a year or two away, you know, more staff are away, more leads are away. What advice can you give about your products and services around how companies can be better during those times? And it's about putting that into, so if you think that summer holidays are something of interest, you write down summer holidays, you put the date of it. Sporting events, you know, maybe you've got some passion yourself, maybe you're into cycling, into golf, maybe you know that you're typically your clients or customers are all football fans or whatever they might be. Let's put these things down, what they are and the dates of them. Are there any key milestones? How long have you been going in business? Is it a year this year? Is it 3 years this year? Is it 12 years this year? What is it? Let's write it down. Our birthday's in April and we will be 3 years old. Let's write it down. TV programs. So I know that a lot of clients that we have are typically our startups or entrepreneurs. A lot of them watch The Apprentice. So in our editorial calendar, we'll have when The Apprentice is next on TV, and we'll have the date of it. So any national days, national weeks, charity campaigns, national competitions, you could come up with themed months, you could come up with patterns in a calendar. So this is about just simply coming up with a list of things and dates. You then take that list of things and dates and you then put it into some kind of roadmap. So you've got sort of the different types of things down the left-hand side. You've got January to February as your roadmap. And so you can start seeing that, for example, in April, we've got Easter, the boat race, it's our fifth anniversary. I realize times are different, but having this go-to calendar over a bigger period of time really will help you. There has to be space in it for crisis as well. And so this doesn't necessarily fix things, but it gives you a bigger idea on how you could have more of a strategic plan. So you come up with the list of things and dates. You've got the January to February to December. You start filling them out. I've got an event calendar template. If you click that link at the top, if you copy it, if you or type it out, or somehow you'll be able to get that link. We can share it with you. If someone wants to pop it in the chat, they're very welcome to. It's a Google sheet that you can download free of charge. Say free, of course it's free, it's just a Google sheet, and it's something that I've created. It's got a list of all the different types of things on the left hand side, January to December going across, and so what the idea is, you'd populate this, and if you were doing a weekly blog, hopefully you'd have three or four topics per month in there to really give you something that would be related to the audience, to your products and services. And just to say, by the way, the events and trade shows doesn't have to be events or trade shows that you're at. So there's three different ways of looking at the events and trade shows. So it could be events and trade shows that you're at. It could be events or trade shows that are in your industry or sector. So I might know about a search engine conference that's going on in Canada in December. It would be in my calendar. It's SEO. I could talk about what's happening at that conference because I can soon Google it, go to their website. I can see who's going to be speaking there. I can see the key takeaways of it. People might assume that I've been to it. I'm not trying to suggest I was there. I'm just trying to suggest that I know what's going on in my industry and I know the key things to be looking at. So the first way is events or trade shows that you're attending. The second thing is events or trade shows that you're aware of in your industry. But the third thing is events or trade shows that you're aware that your audience is attending. So for example, and again, it's not the best example for this crisis right now, but for example, estate agents, their audience probably are familiar with the Ideal Home Show that, you know, typically happens every year. And that could be in their calendar as an event to talk about. So it's very relevant to their business, and it would be in the calendar every single year. So there's a few different ways of looking at events and trade shows, and that's important to mention. So you've got this sheet with all the events. The next step is to add them to a blog calendar. So this time what we're doing is that we're doing January, February, March down, week one, week two, week three, week four, and then across, we're bringing in everything that we've been discussing. So, you know, what potentially is the title of this blog? What's what are the keywords that we might use? When's it got to be done by? Who's going to do it? What are the call to actions that we're going to use? What are all the things that we can think about to add into here to make it as relevant as possible? And again, if someone wants to very kindly copy this link and put it in the chat for me, again, there's a spreadsheet that I've come up with you, which you're very welcome to have. And this goes into a tiny bit more detail. So it starts thinking about the personas. It starts thinking about the different audiences, maybe the different industries, the different sectors. So I know that in week two of February, I know it's Valentine's Day. So let's say in week one, I'm going to do something about love and red and relate that to my products and services. I'm going to focus that on a particular sector. I'm going to focus it on a particular service for a particular audience. I'm going to make sure that we use these particular keywords this is going to be the call to action. And the whole thing starts to become very strategic. It gives you a very clear plan, gives you that accountability. You know, if you're if you've got an hour spare next week, you could write next month's or next quarter's blog, because depending on what it is, things don't change. It's an annual event. Things happen. And you could start writing about it now. So hopefully it gives you that that planning and accountability, but also it makes it much more strategic. Any thoughts on this process? Any questions about this process? I think for me, this is what makes it happen. This is where it really defines who you're talking to, and it. Brings that level of engagement because you're starting to think about who you're writing to, which is so important. And it's the bit that we're going on to very shortly. So just check the, this is excellent. Thank you. The link above doesn't work. The O might be wrong, possibly. E, A, V. Oh, it said someone's put a 9 instead of an 8. So the last thing, the last step is to measure the success. So, you know, have a look how blogs work, have a look at what, whether that brings traffic, whether it brings leads, and over a period of time, really understand if things are delivering or not, to try and understand what topics work and to obviously do more of those topics. I'm not going to do any more polls because I've got lost in what polls I was asking. So actually this was the poll about the personas. We've got another question here from Karen. Are the dates related to industry specific general events or both? Well, the answer is both. So it's up to you. So it's based on your industry, based on your products, based on your services, based on your clients and customers. So as an example, if I sell to solicitors, I'd want to know about the events that are going on in their industry, never mind in my digital marketing industry as well. So it would be both, it all. You know, if you can talk, if you know that it's the annual Law Society dinner in whenever, and hopefully they might actually be happening at some point in the next 10 years. You know, if you start talking about it, you know, I know it's the annual Law Society dinner in September, all of a sudden, solicitors think, actually, yeah, she understands us. And so that's really important. Writing for your audience, let's just bear with me 1 second, just change the screen. Okay, so trying to think of buyer personas. So let's, for example, say we've come up with some personas, and I'll show you how to do this in a second. And we say, you know, actually, you know, who we're trying to sell to is Alison. She's a fund manager in the Southeast. Let's describe her more. What's her typical age? What's her interests? What media does she read? How big are the companies that she works for? How many employees does she have underneath her? Or how many employees does the business have? Is it all sectors we're focused on, or is it particular sectors or industries? James asking, what are the links in your calendar? I probably need to check that myself and understand. I know what that was. Yeah, it's a fair question, so I'll just go back to it. So in the blog calendar here, where I've got the links column, this is for if you've seen a note. So whilst you've been feeding yourself full of information, if you've seen another blog, a Guardian article, you know, a Daily Telegraph article, here's the place to put the link so that when you come to write the blog, you can remember the references that you were looking at. Really important, because what you want to do is link back out to them as well. So anyway, so sorry. So by personas, we've thought of Alison, a fund manager in Southeast. That's who we're trying to sell to. Can we describe them a bit more? Can we give a bit more sort of meat on the bone there? The best way to come up with personas, and I've done this in many other webinars, so I'm not going to spend too long on this right now, but it's around, can we describe the audience? So you might have 2, 3, 4, 5, 15 different target audiences or personas that buy from you. I'll give you an example. So I work with a serviced office provider. They have, I think, 4 or 5 different personas that typically buy from them. So they have corporate Chris, who's looking to rent a sort of 30-man office. They've got small business Steve, who typically is looking to rent a sort of 5-man office. They've got PA Polly, who would be typically inquiring for corporate Chris. They've got and they've got 1 or 2 others, but what they're always thinking about is, who are these people? How do we describe them? And when we're writing a blog, let's write it to Chris, to Polly, to Alison, to Steve. Let's write it in their language, in their mindset. So we need to describe these people. So whether we sell to businesses or to people, people buy from people. So even if a business buys from you, it's still a person that's buying. There's still decision makers within that business. There might be a few decision makers. There might be the assistant that sort of finds you in the first place. There might be a manager that suggests you. There might be a director that signs it off. And it's about understanding all those different people, all how they all work, all their different languages, and then understanding all the different industries and sectors they're in to understand how all the different languages that comes from that as well. So if you're selling to businesses, let's describe the business. What's the ideal type of business you're selling to? So, you know, what's the size of the business? Does it have a particular department? I know that when we're selling marketing, we've got two or three different perfect ideals. One ideal is a sort of 10, 20 employees with no marketing function, no marketing for department. We also know that selling to 2,000 staff with a marketing department is also an ideal. So it's about, you know, what's your ideals, and you might have a number of different personas, and you can have as many as you want, but let's define them as a first point. Can we describe the sector or the industry? What's the ideal place we want to sell? And we might have a number of these ideals, and that's fine. What's their location? What's their, I'm forgetting sophisticated Sarah, you're right, Dan. I did forget sophisticated Sarah. but let's talk about let's define the company. Let's define, the ideal. So is it one that's in Yorkshire that's got 50 staff, that's got, you know, but you might have two or three different types. The next thing is to describe the person. So, you know, what's their job title? Who are they? Who do they report to? What's their gender? What's their age? What's their education? What's their hobbies? What's their interests? What's their pain points? That's the really important bit. The most important bit here is understanding their pain points, because if we can understand their pain points, we can talk in their language, and we can also make them engage with our blogs. Liz has asked a couple of questions. How much do you need to dedicate to blogging, vlogging to be successful in reaching people each week? With a plan, with all of this in place. So the plan that I showed you, putting an editorial calendar together, putting a blog calendar together, I think can be done in half a day. Okay. You're sort of taking half a day out to do this today. I think if you took half a day out, I think you could do a full events calendar and a 3-month blog calendar. I think quite easily. I've done that many times with many businesses. To actually then write the blog, I think depending on how good you are, depending on how long you've been doing it for, I think in reality, 2 to 3 hours a week. I think you've then got to allow for at least half an hour to share the blog as well. So what can you do afterwards as well? So you're potentially looking at 3 to 4 hours a week. Is that something you do yourself, or is that something you can get a colleague to do, or buy someone in to do it? How do you decide on the style, the informal, serious, fun side of things? That's about understanding the audience, which we're going to come on to in a second, understanding the audience and understanding the points, their pain points, and where they currently are. Is it a good idea to find someone who is representative, who would be prepared to be a sounding board before publishing a blog? Absolutely. Always worth checking a blog with someone else first. Jane said 2 to 3 hours per. Does that include research? Yeah, I think it does. Depends on you. But yeah, I think it does. In my experience, research is an ongoing thing. Fair point, Joe. Very fair point. Yeah, I mean, these things sort of naturally start happening, and we sort of feed them into how we do things. So I would say that I'd only take at the most 3 or 4 hours out of my week to work on a blog, at the very most. If I'm on a good week, I can do it in a couple of, you know, an hour to two tops. But yeah, I think research is definitely an ongoing thing. So we've described our personas, and we're not going to do any of these exercises now, but my advice is to try and come up with some personas so that you can get to the point of naming a persona and saying, you know what, today I'm writing to Alison. And think about Alison. Think about just one person when you're writing a blog. Don't think of hundreds, thousands, everyone. Think about how Alison would buy from me. What does Alison need right now? And when you're writing that blog, just think of that one person and choose a different persona each time and share it out and focus more on the ones that you think are where the profit is or where the best business is or where the best case studies are or where you've got the most experience. I'm not saying you can't sell to everyone. What I am saying is sell and market to the people where you've got the most experience, passions, case studies, and focus on them and spread that out over time. What problems do they have? So really important to understand their pain points. So, you know, what are the industry hot debates? What's in the news and the media? What are the FAQs that Alison would typically ask? What are the questions that they're typing into Google? And I've already talked about how to have this editorial calendar, but it's about having a plan. It's about thinking about the target audience. It's about thinking of the key messages. It's about thinking of the different types of content. So I've already shown you the different types, and you could feed that into your editorial calendar. So you could say, well, you know, this week I'm going to write to Alison. This is the product service, and this is the type of content. So I'm going to do a list, or I'm going to do an infographic, or I'm going to do a whatever it might be. Think about how and when to share it, which I'll give you in a moment, and what to link to. So can you link to, you know, if you mention a fact or a figure, can you back it up by linking to that and showing that? And just how I did linking to Danny Brown, that can open some huge doors, and Google likes to see links out. At the same time, can I link in and link to previous content, link to products and services? From an SEO point of view, the more you link in and the more you link to other things on your website, the more you're training Google to like the content on your website. We typically say that 70% of the links should be linking out and 30% of the links should be linking in. So try and link out more than you're linking in. And on a, someone's asked me about the number of words, you know, in an ideal blog, we're probably looking at about 800 words plus, you know, a really ideal blog, a couple of thousand. I mean, they can do amazingly in Google. I realize that I've probably just scared some people, and I'm not saying you have to do this, but in answer to your question, look at Neil Patel's blogs. His are sort of 2,000-3,000 word blogs. They rank so well in Google. But it's not about the quantity of words. It's about the quality. It's, if you've got something quick that you want to just get across, there's nothing wrong with a 200 word blog. But the more in depth, the more resource, the better. I think a minimum of 750, 800 is where you need to be really thinking. And within a 750, 800 word, you might have 10 links, 70% of them linking out, 30% of them linking in. How long should a vlog be? Again, really, really difficult. If you know, so I'm not talking about short videos here. I'm talking about vlogs. I think from a blogging point of view, I think we're talking as an absolute minimum 5 minutes, but really we're thinking sort of 30, 40 minutes, those sort of more in-depth. Let me be clearer about that. I apologize. Video, you're taking me into a slightly different tangent, and there's sort of three different types. You've got the sort of short, sharp stuff. You've got the blog type stuff, which is sort of 5 to 10 minutes. And then you've got the long form stuff, which is 30 to 60 minutes. I think a mix of all of those is the thing to be thinking about there. Killer blog titles. Again, you've got these slides afterwards, so we don't need to spend too long on this screen. But these are some of the tried and tested formulas on what makes people click. So using a number, 7 secrets to success. Teach me, using the word how to do something. Ask me a question. Are you the king of Twitter? Talk to me. Use the word you and your in the title. Saying don't do this. Typically, people then want to do it or want to understand why not to do it. Use celebrities or brands or popular trends within a title. So, you know, Pizza Express is the winner. Email marketing. It's something to you can link. You can engage more with seeing a brand or a celebrity that you're familiar with. Being controversial in blog topics. Blog titles, sorry, and making unusual associations. So help, how lemons help your HR. Stephen, seems a bit large. Do people spend that long reading stuff nowadays? What, 750 or 2000 or 3000? Yeah, I think it depends on what it is. So, you know, if I'm trying to show you how to write the best blog and I give you this webinar in a long form piece of content, there's a huge amount of power in that blog doing very well in Google. So I think it depends on the subject matter, the audience, the, but the answer is yes. I think there are times when long form text can make some big differences. Jane's asking, how much should you charge? I think that's a difficult question to answer, and I'm not sure I want to answer it right now. Only because of the time that I've got and the content I want to get through, and bearing in mind I want to make it relevant to the entire audience, but happy to offer. No, loads that know me will know that I'll happily help you afterwards. So a little blog exercise for yourself. You could think of a persona, you could think of a typical problem they've got, and you could think of, you know, what would be the question, what would be the blog title? That would be a good way of trying to come up with getting you through this and trying to help you think of how you could start writing a blog. And another exercise is what content needs to go into that blog post to answer the question. So you've come up with the question, the title. Now think about what needs to go into it, and make sure that, you know, are you adding value? Are you benefiting the customers? Are you giving them a reason to read? Because like Steve said, you know, are people going to spend that time reading? And you've got to be constantly thinking, why would someone spend their valuable time reading this as opposed to getting their work done? Have you solved the problem? Have you helped them? Those things are really important. And then it's about writing for a purpose as well. So why are you writing? Is it to highlight a service? Is it to gather data? Is it to establish thought leadership in a particular area? Is it adding value to your clients? Is it to show personality? Someone was asking about, you know, what type of blog? So is it fun, humor? Is it, you know, a serious information? So it's about taking people on a bit of a journey. And sometimes you've got to use the sort of fun and humor to get them in the door. But then over time you'll start, so we call that entertaining them. What we then might do is take them into a learning phase where we educate them about our products and services. And then we need to take them into a phase where we try and convert them. So it's about having a constant mix for all the different personas on a regular basis, really. When do the webinar pages get shared, please? So I believe you'll get an email after this. I'm not sure how soon after, but I'm confident you will be getting an email with a link to this recording and lots more. And so a little exercise there is, what do you want the customer to do after they've read the blog? So can you come up with a list of call to actions? You know, do you want them to follow you on LinkedIn, connect with you on Twitter? I've got those the wrong way around, but you understand. Connect on LinkedIn, follow on Twitter. Do you want them to subscribe to something? Do you want them to download something? Do you want them to pick up the phone to you? Do you want them to sign up to a networking event? What are the different call to actions you could have? And can you, again, be a bit more strategic and look back at your editorial plan, the calendar, the blog calendar, and think about, well, okay, this month I'm going to push people to do this call to action. This month I'm going to do this call to action, and spread it out and make sure that you're covering all the different call to actions. This is I know that I could go on for longer, but I'm also very aware that you've given a lot of your time here, and I quite like to finish at 12 because I think there will be some people that need to go. So bear with me. I think I've got 4 minutes left, and I will get there. So just to give you some quick thoughts on how a blog should look, Blacks is a solicitors in Leeds. Many years ago, they came to me and asked me how could they make their blog more engaging. They've got great content, but it wasn't engaging. I said, look, I'm no Photoshop expert, but here's your current blog. This is a step forward. This is a step above. And there's some key things here that you need to be thinking about. So it's about, how can you add subheadings? How can you add bullet points? How can you show the picture of the author and the name of the author? How can you add images to the text? Have a look at how newspapers and magazines share content. Can you add some social proof? Show me that other people have shared this on Facebook or Twitter. Show me some numbers. Give me a way to subscribe to the blog by email, because what you want to do is start building a list of people. And if you've got good blogs and they sign up to them, you can then send them weekly blogs. So it's all about having something that looks really good. It's got to be beautiful. It's got to have some good design in it. People are sheep. People follow each other. So it's about making sure that you can show that other people have engaged with this content. other people have shared it, other people have whatever they've done, making sure that other people can see that that's happened, making people feel welcome on the blog. So using the word you and your, talking to the reader, thinking of Alison and talking in her language and talking to her, making her feel really welcome in the blog. And then lastly, it's about where can you distribute the blog. So that again, there's a whole slide there on different places where you could in, where you could share the blog, from putting it in an annual report to putting it in an email signature to putting it in email campaigns and many other places. But have you even thought about at the bottom of your email signature having this month's top blog or the last month's top blog? It's a great place that you could put it. So it's about having a plan. Who's responsible? Do you have a checklist for sharing? What time of day, what day of the week are you going to share? When, you know, let's make it consistent. Let's do it, you know, if we're going to do a weekly blog, let's do it every Tuesday at 8 o'clock. It's more about consistency than picking the right time of day, to be perfectly honest. I think it's about having some consistency. So it's been a long webinar. We've got through a huge amount. You can rewind and slow me down and pause me. There's lots of ways we can help. All sorts of different digital marketing we offer. The big call to action I've got for you is, during this crisis, we've helped tons and tons of businesses, not with marketing, with everything. Facebook group, Coronavirus Yorkshire Business Support Group. There's loads. It's a place to network. It's a place to help each other. If you know businesses, please invite them in there. If you want to challenge me and you think this is all a load of nonsense, here's my contact details. There's been quite a bit of chat in the last 5 minutes, which I've not had time to get to, but I think there's some brilliant comments. So thank you very much indeed. If there are any questions, please do ask them now. I'm happy to hang around for 10 minutes. But for those that do need to go, I totally understand. Thank you so much for spending your valuable time with me. And I hope it's really been helpful. I don't know if Audrey wants to come in. I'll have a look at what questions we've got. So Lucy, we've already answered that question. Audrey is here.
Thank you for today. It was a killer webinar. I can see a lot of people thanking you. I do suppose they did get a lot of, you know, from this, from today's webinar. And just before all of you go, we've got one more question. The poll question is just for marketing research purposes. And it sounds like this. The Digital Knowledge Exchange and Digital Drive Come to Durham webinar series will always be free of charge to attend. But if you were to pay for a webinar, not necessarily this one, but for any webinar out there that is out there in the internet, would you be willing to pay any amount, or would you not be willing to pay at all? If you could let us know your thoughts, that would be really grateful. And to tell you a little bit more about our next webinar, it will be taking place on Monday next week. And it will be a LinkedIn masterclass session number 3, generating leads that convert. So if you are looking at improving your LinkedIn skills, this is the webinar for you. So you can book it at our website at the moment, and a booking link will be sent in the follow-up email as well. And today's session has been recorded, and the recording will be sent to you as well in the follow-up email with the follow-up survey. So if you could complete that survey as well, that would be really, really grateful, because you know, feedback makes us go forward and improve our webinars. And yes.